we are still going for the paramitas. These qualities needed for full enlightenment. So we have dealt with generosity, ethics, and patience, and now we're dealing with effort. So Atisha says, the supreme effort is letting go of activity. I am taking this to refer to our meditation practice. Many people, when they come to meditation, throw themselves into it with great enthusiasm. And certainly in the Tibetan tradition, when Westerners especially go in for longer retreats, they usually end up getting what is called lung, which is like a pranic imbalance. Sometimes they become very sick. And it's because they're trying too hard. And especially in our modern day and age when our lives are already so stressful, our lives are already filled with more than enough activity, both physical and especially mental, to make our spiritual practice into another form of stress and tension and got to achieve is counterproductive. There's nothing to achieve. There's nothing to gain. It's what we lose that is important, not what we gain. So we must be very careful not to plug in to that same old energy. I've got to get somewhere. What am I going to get out of this? What experiences am I going to get? How long does it take to get realized? That kind of pressure which we put on ourselves is very counterproductive. It's just the ego wanting to be spiritual. A bigger, better, more spiritual me. We can then tell everybody of the fantastic results of our great spiritual endeavors. This is exactly what we don't need. And so even back in the 10th, 11th century, Atisha understood that. And so therefore he says that the supreme effort is letting go of activity. So meditation shouldn't be more effort. I definitely, in the Tibetan tradition at least, the emphasis is on relax. Just relax. Make the mind open, spacious. Now, it's not like we're making the mind relax like lying out on the beach, going to sleep. It's not exactly that kind of relax. It's not going to sleep relax. The mind is aware, is conscious, is very, very clear, totally present. But within this open, spacious feeling in the mind. It's like sort of like a paraglider. You know these paragliders that are out there, they're not making any effort. They're totally poised, but within this vast open expanse. So we have to make our mind like a paraglider. Very present. The paraglider is not going to fall asleep. That paraglider is wide awake. Paraglider? You understand paragliding? I don't know. In India, we call it paragliding. We see them over the sea. Yeah. They have, yes, you know, in those big sort of parachute type things. And they just sail along very... in India, at least, it's called paragliding. So that's how we have to have our mind, like that, you know, very aware, very present, but very effortlessly expansive. It's not a matter of... We don't actually achieve through pushing ourselves, pressuring ourselves. We achieve through relaxing the various levels of the mind while being totally present at the same time. And so this is why he says, I think, that supreme effort, the highest effort, is letting go of all mental activity and just allowing the mind to be as it is, but knowing. So it's not actually, we're not trying to do anything. We're trying to deconstruct and be present at the same time. Aware, conscious, awakening up. Does that make sense? So then the supreme concentration, carrying on from that, the supreme concentration is not altering the mind. Again, we are not trying to constrict the mind into certain patterns. What we're trying to do, as I say, is to deconstruct the mind. We're trying to leave the mind as it is and just know it. Our whole problem is that normally, while we are thinking, while we are feeling, we are totally immersed in that. We're like being in the ocean, we're tossed up and down by the waves. We're totally submerged in our thoughts and our thinking. So the whole point is not so much dealing with the waves as dealing with how to know the waves. Then the waves will subside of their own. We don't have to force them to subside. The more we are aware of the mind, and can witness the mind without being submerged in the mind, the more the mind of itself will begin to quieten down, become more ordered, become more calm and clear. We don't have to try to make the mind clear. We don't have to try to make the mind calm. It will do that of its own account if we only learn how to develop the quality of being conscious, of being aware. So this ability to observe the mind, to know the mind, without being submerged in the mind, of itself will help the mind to heal itself. We don't have to do anything as far as that is concerned. So it looks like we're not doing anything. This is why he says, you know, we have to let go of activity. We should not alter the mind. The whole point is that this conceptual mind of ours, all our thinking and feeling and emotions, all of that tumult would deal with itself if only we could learn how to step back and just be aware. We don't have to do anything. We just have to know the mind at that moment, without judging it, without trying to change it. Then of itself, it will heal. It will solve its own problems. This is a very important point in meditation. We're not trying to, you know, engineer the mind into some kind of unreal posture. We are going with the flow of the mind, but knowing the mind. Because we don't know our mind. It's extraordinary because we live within the mind. Everything that we know from outside, we can only know because we are conscious. And what we stimuli we receive from external, the seeming external reality that we posit through the sense doors is programmed immediately by our sixth consciousness, the mental consciousness. So even our seeming outside reality depends on the mind. And then within the mind, all our thoughts, our memories, our ideas, our beliefs, our sense of identity, it all depends on thought. Everything is thought. We're swimming in this ocean of thought. But like a fish, because we are so used to it, we don't know what is the nature of water. So it's very important to begin to understand what is a thought, because we are so mastered by our thoughts, governed by our thoughts. So what is a thought? And as Swamiji said, what is a thought? Who is the thinker? It's not enough just to read a book about it or hear a lecture. We, each one of us, have to individually examine our own mind, question our own mind, really look into our own mind. What is a thought? Where does it come from? Where does it go to? What does it feel like? What is a thought? Our whole life is governed by our thoughts. What is a thought? And who is thinking? Once we really begin to examine this, this is what changes our internal landscape. And it comes from being more and more aware, more and more conscious, more and more mindful, looking at the mind itself. We're always looking outside. Now, turn that attention inside. Yes, so, the supreme wisdom, the highest wisdom, is not to grasp onto anything as a self. So, basically, we grasp onto everything as a self. The ego tends to reach out to everything and think, this is me, this is mine. And that is basically our primordial ignorance. We mistake completely who we really are. And because of this, we are immersed in samsara. The antidote is wisdom. Wisdom means knowing very well, understanding from direct experience. It's not something we can read about things and think about things, which is important. We should study and we should think about what we have studied. Do we understand it really? Does this make sense for us? But then we have to integrate it. We have to become it. It's not enough that it stays up in the head as a brain activity. It has to come down into the center of our being so that then we transform. As long as it stays up in the head, it doesn't change anything. You know, yes, we know patience is good. Yes, we know we should be forbearing. Yes, we know that we should be grateful to other people who irritate us because they're helping us to learn patience. But then somebody upsets us and oh, but wait a minute, I spent a week developing patience. So that's because our understanding is up here. We know all the answers up here, but it hasn't percolated down to become who we are and transform us within. And it's only when it comes down and becomes our true nature that we can say that we have genuinely transformed. So this takes time, but it's very important. Without that, it's not something which is going to really alter us at a very deep level. This is why many people, they for example, they come to here, they do yoga courses, or they do meditation courses, and they gain so much from it, so much inspiration, so much enthusiasm, and then they go home, and if they're not very careful, the whole thing kind of dissipates again. And they think, where did that go? I was sure that that was forever. And it's because it takes time for wisdom to really, really arise in our continuum. That, you know, just to know it's something intellectually is not the same as becoming it. So, therefore, the highest wisdom is not to grasp on anything as a self, especially not, you know, first of all, our false identification with our conceptual thinking mind and with all our egoic preoccupations. Everything that we are doing in our mind, thinking, is the ego. It's not the wisdom mind. But we need the ego to help us to discover, uncover our true nature. Then we can use the ego or not as we want to, but we're not fooled by it. At the moment, we think it's who we really are. This is our problem. Once we recognize, no, it's just the ego, then, well, the ego can also be useful, but it's not, we don't identify anymore. It's something we can use. That's enough. It's not me, it's not mine. We don't mistake it for ourselves. And likewise, our possessions, people we love, our family, our partners, our children, and so forth, all of this, they are not me, they are not mine. We have to learn to love, genuinely love, without attachment. Somebody asked that question yesterday, and of course it's a very deep question which comes up again and again, because people confuse attachment or detachment, non-attachment, with coldness, with not caring. But that's completely wrong. It's attachment which is a problem. Because attachment holds on, it grasps on tightly, never wants, you know, you're mine, therefore you must act like this and this and this in order to make me happy, because you belong to me. And this is what causes so much problem in the world, in families and in relationships. Sometimes, simplistic as it is, I say the difference between attachment and love is that attachment says, I love you, therefore I want you to make me happy. And love says, I love you, and I want you to be happy. Whether that includes me or not is irrelevant. I mean, we hope it will include me, but if it doesn't include me, still, may you be well and happy. That's the important thing. That's love, when you're thinking of the other's happiness. Otherwise, attachment is just another form of ego enhancement, ego grasping. It's not love. We shouldn't mistake it. Love is like the sunshine. It just shines on everybody. It doesn't discriminate. Of course, some countries are hotter than others. You might think the sun was favoring those countries. And, you know, those people who karmically we have a relationship with, naturally, we are going to give them special care and love. But still, we have to recognize them as they are following their own karma and give them space to be who they are instead of wanting them always to be how we want them. So, I mean, I could go into this forever, but we have to get on. Sorry. But the important thing is not to grasp onto anything, either our own ego or other people, as being me and mine. Because that causes suffering. The Buddha said that the cause of suffering after ignorance was our grasping mind. And this is something very deep inside our psyche, and it causes suffering. We think it's the cause of joy. We think that holding on tightly, the more we hold on, the happier we will be. But actually, it just is the root of hopes and fears and insecurity, because everything is impermanent, including people. And if we accept that and hold it lightly, there's one in Australia, very famous cartoonist called Lunik, who is a very, very spiritual man. And he did this cartoon, a series of pictures about how to have love and respect for each other. And one of them, which I remember, was he said, it's like a day-old chick, a little baby chicken. You hold it very gently, carefully. If you go like that, no chicken. And that is like love, you know? If you hold too tightly, you kill it. You're just left with attachment. You have to hold it very gently, very lovingly, our relationships. The supreme spiritual teacher is the one who exposes our hidden flaws. And the supreme instruction is the one that helps us to strike at those flaws. So that is rather like Swamiji was talking about yesterday on the question about truth. That truth should be kind, but kind does not always mean pleasant. That's very, very, very true, especially in the guru-student relationship. Any guru who only says to you what you want to hear is not a true guru. It doesn't help. It's like in yoga. If you have a yoga teacher who is only praising your asanas, even when you're doing it wrong, what kind of teacher is that? You want a teacher to say, no, don't keep your legs like that. Hold them straight and put them together, not flopping all over the place. You know, what are you doing here? Come on, you didn't listen to me. Put them together, straight. And you're grateful. You're not angry. That's what you've got a teacher for. A teacher is not only to show us the right way to do something, but to point out when we're doing it wrong. That's why we have confidence. That's why we trust. Because we genuinely believe that the guru or the teacher understands us better than we understand ourselves. Otherwise, how can they direct us? How can they be a guide? So, therefore, we welcome, or we should welcome, criticism. and the fact that they are able to see our flaws, and that those teachings and direction which they give will help us to compensate for those flaws. It's obvious. Any kind of instruction which is merely praising you up and making your ego float is pretty useless. Of course, we all need encouragement. But nonetheless, more important than just encouraging us is to show us how to do things better, where we've gone wrong in any skill. I mean, if you're learning to play an instrument, if you're learning sport, if you're learning, as I say, you're anything. The instructor is there to help us to see our faults and show us how to correct them. Otherwise, it would not be a good instructor. I mean, that's obvious. So some teachers do this in a very kind and mild manner. Some teachers do this in a very ferocious manner, depending on the teacher, depending on the student, depending on what will be most helpful. But we should certainly welcome, even, and not just from the teacher, guru sitting on the throne, but from anyone, actually. When we receive criticism, our first reaction should not be to become defensive, but to ask ourselves, is what they are saying true? If they are pointing out to us some hidden fault, then we should be grateful. Thank you. I never noticed that. No, yes, right, okay. And if, with honest self-introspection, we don't see that actually that is a fault, or that sometimes people project their own inadequacies onto others, then we can say, no, I have many faults, but that doesn't happen to be one of them. And just let it go. But definitely, and when we receive any correction, it's very important to hear it and to really look into our heart to see whether or not this is accurate or not accurate. And of course, from a teacher, one would assume that, as I say, they really see. The whole point of a teacher, a guru, is a guide. So you always will assume that the guide has reached the destination that we are trying to travel on, not just read the guidebooks like us, that they've actually got there. So they have that confidence. Yes, this is the path. Don't go that way. Go this way. And then when you go a certain distance, turn left. Because they know the terrain. And therefore, we have confidence. And the humility to hear. We're getting on beautifully. Look at this. The supreme companions are mindfulness and alertness. So here, he is, these two aspects of the mind go together in Buddhist parlance. In Tibetan, they're called Trenpa and Shejin. Trenpa here means the ability to be aware, to be conscious, not only of our mind, but of our body and our speech, just to be present. This is a very important quality it's nowadays in psychology also, it has become a very important practice for people with psychiatric problems. I mean, the whole magazine, psychiatric magazines, are devoted to mindfulness. It's the new buzzword. In Buddhism, mindfulness has many, many connotations and is much more than just merely being present and aware. But for now, we'll keep it at that. Along with that ability to become more conscious of how we are in the moment is this other quality, which is untranslatable. And therefore, every translation has a different take. You have to know what the word is to know what they're talking about. Here, they call it alertness. Some people say introspection. Some people say clear comprehension. There are many different... Nobody has the exact term. And you can always tell when there is not the equivalent in English because every translator tries a different word. Nobody... There just isn't quite that word. So, but what it means is simple. What it means is the ability to check up what the mind is doing. Somebody described it as spying on the mind. You're just looking. It's a quality of the mind which, while we're meditating, is also very useful. It comes up and it looks. How's it going? And if there is anything which needs correction, for example, the mind is sinking and becoming very sleepy, and often this is a big hindrance in meditation because people can get into a kind of somnambulant state and think that they're meditating. You know, they feel very peaceful, they never want to move. But actually, there's no clarity in the mind. There's no spark in the mind. The awareness is completely sunk. And so it's like a half sleep. This is called sinking. The opposite, which we know, and in some ways is less dangerous because we can see it's a problem, is the mind being very distracted. That we all recognize is a problem. But this other sinking mind could be mistaken for going into deep meditation. It's very important that in meditation, the mind is not only relaxed, but extremely alert. It's like waking up. It's not going to sleep. And so the mind should be more clear, more aware, more absolutely bright, while all the other faculties of the mind rest and stay quiet. So therefore, this Shejin aspect is the one that checks up. It perks up, looks, sees what the mind is doing, how's the meditation going. Depending how the meditation going, it will adjust until it's back on track again. Then it subsides. It's not there all the time. It's just that, I mean, being there all the time would make the mind too tense. But it just looks, sees, if everything's okay, everything is going well, then it just dissolves back again. If things are not going well, we're sinking, or we're really too distracted, then it will apply the antidotes. So these two go together at all times, not just when we are meditating, but as much as possible during the day, we should try to really bring our whole life into the focus of being mindful, of being conscious of what we're doing. The Buddha himself had four levels of mindfulness, starting with the body, that includes breath. So, and it also, the very, very start that the Buddha recommended was to be conscious of our posture. So therefore he says, when we are standing, we know we are standing. When we are sitting, we know we are sitting. When we are walking, we know we are walking. When we're lying down, we know we're lying down. So very basic, what is our body doing in this moment? Then this also includes the breath. The breath is a very good aid to our mindfulness because we are always breathing. Normally, we are not conscious of breathing. It's one of those automatic functions that just goes on. But the moment that we bring our attention to the breath, we are present. Because as I said yesterday, we can't breathe in the past or the future. We only breathe now. So the moment that we bring our attention to the breath going in and out, that moment at least, we're present. So this is something which also, you know, when one is driving, when one's walking, when one's doing any activity, there can also be this consciousness of the body and this consciousness of the breath. And then the second one was to be aware of the sensations. This is the Goenka. Any of you might have taken a Goenka Vipassana course. He focuses on the sensations in the body. Because normally we are not conscious of how much energy there is actually constantly in the body and how much feeling. So going from the soles of the feet to the top of the head and then back again, this sweeping through the body to become conscious of the energies, the vibrations within the body. So this is the mindfulness on sensation. The Tibetans tend to be more interested in mindfulness of the mind. And so this is what they emphasize, is being conscious, aware of what is happening in our minds while it is happening. Normally, as I say, we are quite unconscious. We just get swept along by our thought stream. And we are identified with our thought stream. All our thoughts and feelings and ideas and perceptions and so forth. This, we identify this with who I am. And so in order to begin to loosen that very false identification, we need to develop this quality of mindfulness or awareness of the thoughts so that we see thoughts are just thoughts. They're not me, they're not mine. They're like bubbles, you know, very bright, very shiny, but plink, empty. Why do we solidify them and make them so as if they were something permanent and real when we all know that moment to moment to moment is just a flow? So we need, again, to develop this quality, not only during our meditation, but at all times that we can remember to do it during the day to become awake. What is going on in the mind in this very moment? How is the body positioned in this very moment? And gradually, gradually make ourselves more and more conscious. Because much of our time, however hard we think we're working, the stress comes not from the task that we are doing, but from all this other stuff which is going on in the head at the same time, that we're trying to fight our way through to get ourselves concentrated on what we need to do. That's what's stressful. Our minds are really totally out of control. and we're the slaves. I mean, imagine the one thing which we take with us everywhere we go is our mind, even when we're asleep. And yet we don't know our mind. We're the slaves of our mind. The mind is often very mean to us and says all sorts of nasty things to us that we would never say to anybody else. So it's very important to really, if we want to live happily in this world, to really get to know the mind, understand the mind, and become the masters of the mind, so that we have a good companion to travel with. Wherever you have come from, you come here to the Bahamas, but you've still got your mind, same old mind. We can go to Mars, we take our mind with us. You know, I mean, so it's, since we never can escape from our mind, it is very important that we have a mind that is a pleasure to live with, at least that much. Then we can feel happy. But for many people, their mind is their worst enemy. Then they get depressed, of course. The supreme inspiration, let's see what inspiration is in Tibetan. Kulma. Okay, the supreme inspiration is enemies, hindrances, disease, and suffering. So normally, we regard things like enemies, people who are mean to us and not nice and hurt us and cheat us and boss us around, and hindrances, obstacles, difficulties, disease, sickness, suffering in general, as being an obstacle to our practice. We think that if we are surrounded by beautiful Dharma friends and we are in good health and everything is beautiful around us, then we can practice. When we go back and are faced with difficult people and noise and all the problems of our modern civilization, and we get sick, and there are so many difficulties, I can't practice. And so it's very, very important, and this was one of the main teachings of Chor Atisha, to recognize that difficulties and obstacles, sickness and enemies and so forth, far from being the obstacle to our practice, are the opportunities for our practice. It's a very, very important point. If we go to a gymnasium or we go to practice yoga, we start off with pretty flabby muscles. And the way to strengthen our muscles, strengthen our bodies, become strong, is either by, you know, getting on those machines in the gym and pedaling away, or by doing sustained yoga asanas, which will strengthen the body and challenge the body. If the posture is too easy, then we will not progress. So slowly we welcome more and more difficult asanas in order to make the body stronger and stronger, more subtle and supple and flexible. I mean, it's very nice to lie out on the beach. But if one spends the whole time here just lying out on the beach, one is not going to get a strong body. One gets a strong body by attending yoga classes and doing asanas. And likewise, in life, if everything goes easily and pleasantly, and one is only surrounded by people who are kind and loving and do and say exactly what we want them to do and say, that is very pleasant. But we don't learn much. It's very easy to be loving towards people who are lovable. The question is, are we loving towards people who are obnoxious? This is the question. So instead of resenting people, for example, who create problems for us and are difficult for us, and seeing them, as it says here, as the enemy, well, at least as somebody who is, you know, opposing us, instead of projecting out a negative feeling towards that person, we can see this person as our guru, our teacher of patience, our teacher of forbearance. Now, patience, as you will remember, is one of the qualities needed for enlightenment. How are we going to learn to be patient and forbearing if we never have anybody who opposes us? So therefore, when somebody is difficult, instead of thinking, oh, you know, this is too difficult, this person is really an obstacle for my peace of mind, we can be grateful to them because they are helping us to develop this quality, which is very important in the world, and which without them, we would not be able to develop. Do you understand? So this turns the whole thing around. One time when I was in India, I was in Kerala, I think, and my friend wanted to meet this famous astrologer. So I went along. And so while he was there with all his books, I thought, well, let's ask. So I said, okay, I have a choice here. Either I can go back into retreat. This was just after I left retreat. I said, either I can go back into retreat or I can start a nunnery. What shall I do? So he looked it all up. And then he said, well, if you go into retreat, very peaceful, very happy, very conducive. If you start a nunnery, many problems, many challenges, many difficulties. But both are good, so you decide. So, of course, I thought, okay, back into retreat. Coward. But I met with this Catholic priest, and I told him, and he said, well, of course you start the nunnery. He said, we are like pieces of rough wood, and if we always stroke ourselves with silk and velvet, that is very nice, but we don't become smooth. In order to become smooth, we need sandpaper. So, when we meet with difficult people, when we meet with difficult circumstances, that is our sandpaper for making us smooth. And so, rather than resenting this, we should be grateful. What can I learn from this? If we are sick, instead of lying there feeling sorry for ourselves, we can practice what is called tonglen, which is this meditation where with the ingoing breath, we visualize bringing in all the sickness and suffering and karmic causes of the sickness and suffering from that the other people, and then breathing out well-being and light and love and so forth. This is a very profound meditation. I'm not explaining it, but we make use of our suffering. Many Tibetans, during the communist takeover and the Cultural Revolution, many lamas were imprisoned, of course. And they had not done anything wrong, but they happened to be lamas in a position in a monastery, so they were imprisoned and put in labor camps. And many of them, because they still had loyalty to His Holiness and to the Buddha Dhamma Sangha and refused to pretend otherwise, went through many years of torture and interrogation. And eventually, after 20, 25, 30 years, they were released. And if one met them, it was very interesting. I've met several of them. And instead of, you know, being broken, sometimes physically they were in bad shape, but you look in their eyes and they're just glowing with love and compassion. And one of them who was daily interrogated and humiliated and tortured for many, many years, he said how grateful he felt to his torturers for helping him to develop great compassion. And you looked at him and you know he meant it. He said, I learned all about compassion when I was in the monastery. I had no idea. I would never have understood except for my tormentors, my jailers. They really helped me on the path. I'm so grateful to them. And I really hope that they themselves will attain enlightenment. So this is what, of course, most of us are not going to end up in prison being tortured. But what we're talking about is that even the most awful things can be taken on the path, can be used skillfully. That the things which we learn about and you know, intellectualize about become a reality when we are faced with real challenges. Then we know how we're doing, because it's very easy to be lovely and smiling and namasteing everybody in such a beautiful environment where everybody is friendly. You know, I mean, here at the ashram, people look at each other. They greet each other. Even complete strangers will greet each other. They have friendly heart. So it's easy to be friendly with friendly people. And this is beautiful. I mean, I'm not putting it down. I'm not saying that therefore everybody should learn to be mean. It's wonderful, and it's a refuge for people, you know, to remind us that the world actually is full of beautiful people, despite what we read in newspapers and on the news. Actually, the world is mostly full of people who you know, are good people trying. And it's beautiful, but we don't learn anything from that, not much. I mean, yes, we learn to be friendly to friendly people, but the real challenge is to be friendly to unfriendly people. I mean, personally, my own this quality of taking difficulties and enemies, sickness, all the challenges of life onto the path, making that the path, is what lojong means. This word lojong, mind training. And for me personally, my lojong practice is the Foreign Registration Office of the police in Dharamshala, where we have to go to tell them we're leaving, coming back, renew our visas and things like this, and you've got all these guys there. I mean, it's a good lojong practice because also one can feel compassion, you know, because they're endlessly dealing with frantic foreigners, begging them, you know, for extensions of their visas and getting all uptight and upset, and they have to deal with this day by day by day. I don't think they deal with it skillfully, but they definitely, it's not a job that anyone would envy. And the minute you go into the office, you can feel it, you know, that tension there. And these poor guys, we just have to go in and then go out, and they have to live there all day long. So this quality of taking all the difficulties that we meet in our life and using that as the opportunity to develop ourselves is a very, very important one. In Buddhist cosmology, the highest realms are the various 26 levels of God realms, from very sensuous realms to extremely mind-only realms, and all stages in between. But their one characteristic is that they are pleasurable. They are the result of good karma, and so you have body of light, anything you want, it just spontaneously appears. Everything is delightful. It appears that one's life goes on forever. It doesn't, of course, when the good karma is finished, then we come down. But at the time when they're up there, they think it's all very wonderful. And everything is love and light. But it is regarded as essentially a spiritual dead end because one isn't learning anything. There's no need. Everything's lovely. There's no incentive. There's no inspiration to transform the mind because everything is so pleasurable. Endlessly, it seems. On the other hand, on the other extreme, the very lower realms, which are a projection of a very distorted mind, are unremitting suffering. And so one is so caught up in one's paranoia that one cannot think outside of oneself and has no energy left over to try to develop spiritually. And therefore, the human realm is considered the ideal realm for spiritual progress because we have this balance of pleasure and pain. The pleasure helps us, you know, keep going. It's, you know, we need also as animals to have pleasure. But the pain, the difficulties, the challenges in life are what help us to develop spiritually. Most people, when they get to a certain age, recognize that actually where they really developed was during times of great difficulty. At the time, it was very painful. But if we go through that, then looking back, we can see that actually this was very helpful for us. We learned a lot from that. And so, therefore, it's very important to recognize that the difficulties of life, the challenges of life, our losses, our sickness, antagonisms that we meet from others, and so forth, are calling us to practice. How can we deal with this situation skillfully? What can I learn from this? How can I use this on the path? So for this reason, it's called an inspiration. It's a kulma. Kulma means, you could like use, it's a bit like a whip or a stick to exhort a horse to go forward, to put more effort into it. You know, if you give them a smack and they go forward more, that's a kulma. It's like an incentive to practice. So we shouldn't want that always life should be just pleasurable and everything should go the way I want it to go. And, you know, when things don't go the way I want them to go, therefore that's wrong. That's just the ego speaking. In fact, we often learn far more from our difficulties and problems and challenges than we do when everything goes exactly the way we had, the ego had planned things to be. So this is a very important point, because it means that everything that happens to us, we use it as the path. Nothing needs to be discarded. Everything, from everything we can learn. I mean, I think one of our problems is that nowadays, especially, the idea is that a good life is a life which is full of comfort. And as many problems as we can avoid and just keep everything going nice and smoothly, that's a good life. But, you know, to my mind, if all we want is to be comfortable, well-fed, looked after and loved, we should pray to come back as a pet dog. I mean, look at Moo. You know, she's loved, she's fed, she doesn't have to work, she has no problems. I mean, if that's all we want from life, but is that what we're here for? Aren't we here to learn, to develop, to transform? In which case, we have to take everything onto the path and use it. Nothing is discarded. One lama said to me one time, a very traditional lama, I was complaining about this and that and the other. And he said to me, if you say obstacle, it's an obstacle. If you say opportunity, it's an opportunity. And this is true. There is nothing which happens to us that we cannot learn from. The supreme method is to be natural. And again, I will take this to mean that we, exactly what it says, that we shouldn't try to be something we're not. That you are not all going to transform yourselves into, unless you are Indian, you're not going to try to transform yourself into Indians. We are not trying to transform ourselves into something which we are not. We're trying to express our true nature and not pretend to be something we're not. Certainly, within my own spiritual tradition, it is, as with a yogic tradition, sometimes it's difficult to discriminate what is culture and what is actually the spiritual path. And to a certain extent, we can absorb the culture too. But nonetheless, we have to recognize that the culture is just a culture. It's not the path. This becomes very clear in Buddhism, where it went to many different countries after India and absorb the culture of those countries. So you have Chinese Buddhism, Japanese Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, Thai Buddhism, and so forth. And so there you can see very clearly how the essential Dharma truth took on the flavoring and the coloring of the culture which it went to. Buddhism is very absorbent like that. It was very happily absorbed into anything. And at the same time, maintain its integrity. So it's very important to... When I first met my Lama, he said to me, always recognize that Tibetan Buddhism is half culture, half Buddhism. So you can throw out the culture, just don't throw out the Dharma. But of course, it's not so easy because, you know, it's not like here's culture, here's Dharma, boom. you know. By this time, it's all gone like this. So sometimes it's difficult to separate what is actually just cultural and helpful for Tibetans, but not necessarily helpful for non-Tibetans, and what is genuine Dharma. And likewise with the Hindu tradition, a lot of it is Indian culture. And while one can adopt that to a certain extent, one also has to discriminate because, you know, one shouldn't try to become the perfect Indian. That's not the point. One should be natural. And look at the teaching and apply it to oneself and one's own life. And not try to pretend to be something one is not. In Mahayana Buddhism, then that would be like pretending to be an eighth-level bodhisattva when we hardly know how to even look at the mind. It's like trying to pretend to be something beyond what we are. Of course we are striving. Of course we are aspiring. Of course we are trying. But we have to be honest with ourselves and with others. Not try to pretend a role. We are all playing roles. We play the role of our gender, the role of our nationality, of our race, of our social positions, of our professions, our education, our religion. But within that role, we play roles of being mothers and fathers, of being daughters and sons and family and friends and whatever. I mean, endlessly we are playing roles. That's fine, as long as we recognize they're just roles. Some of these roles are very useful, some of them are. The problem is when we identify with the roles and we think that's who we really are. And so it's no good putting on, you know, the word personality comes from the word persona, which was the mask which was used in Greek and Roman plays. They didn't show the face of the actors. They wore masks to portray the role they were playing. So our persona is the mask we're wearing to depict the role we are playing, which is fine as long as we don't identify with that. We recognize it's just a persona. It's just a mask. And in this way, we remain, therefore, true to ourselves. We remain natural. We don't try to pretend to be something that we're not. Especially in spiritual circles, this is important. Because, you know we have to be kind. We all know we have to be loving. We all know we have to be peaceful. We all know, and on and on and on. And so we try to be that. I think especially people living in ashrams. We try to impersonate the person we think we should be. But sometimes if we are not honest about that, then that sets up a lot of inner tension because we're suppressing our true, the feelings we really have because we know that's not acceptable. And then later on, that can create a lot of stress and depression. Because we're not being true to ourselves and our level of development at this time. It doesn't mean that if somebody annoys us, we can just be angry. I mean, but we have to recognize that we feel angry, even if we don't respond with anger, because anger is not skillful, and so we try to be patient. That's fine. That's good. That's part of the practice. But if we deny to ourselves that we actually are very irritated, then we're in trouble. At least we should be honest with ourselves. Do you understand what I'm saying? Of course we are trying to improve. But we have to be honest. Otherwise we end up just playing a part. It's not real. The supreme way of benefiting is to help others to enter the Dhamma. So this is what everyone here is trying to do. We can benefit beings in many, many ways. And our life should be dedicated to benefiting ourselves and benefiting ourselves through our spiritual practice and others through what we have gained from our spiritual practice. And to share that with others is, of course, the best way to help. And nowadays, I think that more and more people are receptive to that. They're desperately looking for some meaning to their lives and some way out of the morass in which they find themselves. So places like this ashram are so important in this world. They're lights in this world, to really help people to heal and to come to something which is genuine, is true in the midst of all the lies which we are surrounded with in our society. So therefore, indeed, even if we only know this much, to share that, not by proselytizing and knocking on people's doors, but if people are interested, if they want to know, to share what we know. It just came in my mind. In the Pali canon, there were these two friends who are called Shariputra Moggallana. And they were looking for spiritual truth. They were two Brahmins. They were going around everywhere looking for truth. And one day they came to this monk, this bhikkhu, this Buddhist monk, and they said, "So what does your master teach?" And the monk said, "Well, actually, I've only been monk for a week, and I really don't know anything much." And they said, "No, no, but still, what you know, tell us what it is." And so he said, "Of all things springing from a cause, the Buddha has explained the cause and also how things cease to be. This is the teaching of the great sage." And this is a very famous Sanskrit. Om ye dhamma hetun dhubhava hetun tatanta dhagato e avadat hevanta me pravadva e vashramana soha. It's something which even the Tibetans say in Sanskrit. Anyway, because they had been studying with so many gurus, they got it like that, and they went to the Buddha, and then eventually they became his chief disciples. So that monk didn't know much. You know, of all things springing from a cause, the Buddha has explained the cause, and also how things cease to be. But just that was enough to ignite these two seekers. If he had not shared that much, they would never have gone to the Buddha. So each one of us, you know, we have a certain knowledge. And that much knowledge, if people are interested and willing, we can share it. But more than our words, we benefit others by our example. It's one thing to talk. It's another thing to do. When your family say to you, "Oh, you're ever so much nicer nowadays. What are you doing?" Then you know you're on the right path. Because then they think, "Wow, you know, you're nicer. Must be working, whatever it is you're doing. What is it?" "Oh, so you did a month in Sivananda Ashram. That sounds good. How do I, get in on it?" Many, many people, I'm sure, who come to places like this come because they have been influenced by the behavior of others. They see them, they think, "Wow, it worked for them. Maybe it could help me." So in this way, it's not a matter of standing on street corners preaching. It's a matter of incorporating what you know into your life so that it inspires and benefits others. And then they also want to know more. They're attracted by the light like a moth. And this is the greatest gift we can give to anyone. Is the gift of spiritual truth and a path. And all of us can do this. You don't have to dress in robes. Each one of us takes what they have learned and incorporates it into our life. And then people are interested. They are searching, the most unlikely people. You would be surprised. Even their own family don't know that they are actually thinking what they're thinking and looking and searching. So each one of you could be a catalyst for someone. So the supreme benefit is a mind that turns towards the Dharma. So again, the fact is that what will benefit us most is a life which genuinely is directed to the spiritual life. That we don't just become spiritual when we come to ashrams. It's not the body that takes on the Dharma. It's the mind. And so the greatest benefit for ourselves and for others is a mind that turns towards the spiritual and places the spiritual at the very center of our life, not at the periphery when we have time. Everything we do, everything we say, everything we think should be an expression of our desire to merge with the Dharma, with the spiritual. If the mind does not turn to the spiritual path, no matter how much outer activity we may engage in, nothing inwardly will transform. The mind has to turn towards the Dharma, not turn outwardly always towards external distractions. It doesn't mean that we cannot live a normal life, but we live a life which nonetheless is soaked in our view. In Buddhism, the view is considered to be the crux of the matter. How our outlook, our understanding, how we think, what is important, what is not important, our view of everything. That colors everything that we do and say. So therefore, it's very important that the Dharma is at the center of our lives. is the pivot around which everything else spins. Cultivating qualities of the heart and mind. Taking everything and using it to develop ourselves and benefit others. That is the center of our life. Then that means the mind turned towards the Dharma. Otherwise, outwardly, we can do all these outwardly looking, good-looking things, but it hasn't transformed anything inside. What we have to do is transform. Transform ourselves to, and wake up. We're all asleep. We need to wake up. And having woken up, we wake up others. Then that is a life well lived. And at the time of death, whenever that should be, we can die without regrets. Knowing I use this life meaningfully to benefit myself, to benefit others. So this is good news. Don't look so worried. What's the time? Okay, I'll take one or two questions if there are any. We don't want to go on too long. You've sat for already.
It is our own intentions and many imperfections that create suffering for others and ourselves. You said yesterday even a baby is born with the innate trait of to crave. What might have been the intention of the Creator to not just create, let's say, a universe of eternal bliss where we don't even need problems, hindrances, famines, world wars, Hitlers, etc., to learn?
This is a question you should ask Swamiji, because Buddhists don't believe in a creator. The Buddha said that the universe is created by the karma of the beings occupying that universe. So as long why it happened that we do have these deep sources of ignorance and from that greed and anger, who knows? It's something which is happened an awfully long time ago in the endless cycle of birth and rebirth. The Buddha said, when somebody asked him why, all these negative emotions in our mind and how was that created? He said, it's like someone being shot with a poison arrow and then saying, no, don't touch the arrow. I want to know what was the species of bird which was from those feathers and what kind of wood was on the shaft and what was the caste of the arrow maker and so forth and so forth. And he said, you'd be dead before you answered those questions. The point is to pull out the arrow. So as I say, the from a Buddhist point of view, our sufferings and the wars and our distress, as well as our joys and pleasure, are created by the karma of the beings who occupy this planet, not just human beings, but all beings. And if we continue to make negative karma, we will have negative results. So the important thing, therefore, is not to worry why this happened, but to recognize that it is happening and to eradicate the negativities in our own mind.
Hi. My question is about the difference, because it seems like a subtle difference between observing the mind and not allowing it to be, but then also allowing mindfulness to come in and notice what's happening, and if things are going okay, allow it, and then if there's something that needs to be, the difference, that subtle control, where? Okay.
Yeah. Well, it's a different times. When one is meditating, for example, doing shamatha or vipassana meditation, at that time we need to check up what is happening, so that we can get it balanced. At other times, when one is just allowing the mind to be in its natural state, then we would not use that. It's a different practices at different times. But in general, for once we have got that ability to focus the mind, then we can allow just the thoughts to come up. And from time to time, you see, this shichin doesn't stay there for long. It just looks and sees how it's doing. It has the mindfulness declined. If the mindfulness is still clear and shining, then it doesn't interfere with anything. It's only only if the mindfulness has declined that it brings it up again. Do you understand? I mean, it's important to because if we think we're being mindful, we might not be. Right? I mean, our mindfulness can sink. And so from time to time, we have to make sure that it's still functioning. You're not dealing with the thoughts. You're dealing with making sure that the mindfulness is still clear. So it's accompanying the mindfulness, right? It's like a support for the mindfulness, to make sure the mindfulness is still, the awareness is still bright and shining, and it's not declined.
Thank you. How do we know the difference between what is true? This is on the supreme method is to be natural, right? Mm-hmm. The supreme method mm-hmm. is to be natural. Mm-hmm. So you spoke about the persona, the mask that we wear. Mm-hmm. How do we distinguish between the persona and what is true? How do we even reach for that?
And that's what meditation is about. Because while we're sitting in meditation, there's no persona. We're not playing any role. We're not even, there's not even a gender bias. I mean, while one is meditating, one is not male, one is not female. One is not a wife or a mother, or our race is irrelevant. We are just sitting there observing the mind. And in sitting there observing the mind, there's no role to play. So then we begin to understand gradually. Once our awareness becomes very powerful, then we can become aware of the awareness. Because, you know, you have the thoughts, and then you have that which is watching the thoughts. But then we have to observe the observer. But of course, we cannot really observe the observer. So then when we try to observe the observer, like the eyes looking at themselves, something else happens, and the whole edifice falls away, and we go into a much more profound level of non-dualistic consciousness, which all religions recognize. They call it many names. But all spiritual traditions rather than religions. Religions tend to be very dualistic. But all genuine spiritual traditions recognize that there is a level of awareness beyond thought, no subject object. That is our true nature and is absolutely beyond roles. But before that, even just mindfulness, bare mindfulness is in itself, it's very pure. It doesn't have to do with who we are, the games we're playing in our life. And so then we can recognize that, you know, we have to play these roles. A mother has to be a mother. And it's perfectly fine, you know, as long as we don't think that's who I am. It's a role I'm playing. And as I say, the way to directly see that is when we are in a state of, for example, meditation, where one can drop all one's roles. Haven't you found that? I mean, when we are meditating, we're not thinking who I am. All that just falls away. There is just this awareness and the thought flow. But, you know, it's not male or female or old or young or American or Israeli. I mean, it's irrelevant. Isn't it? So as long as we remember that, then we can happily play as many roles as we want, as long as we don't identify. I mean, we can play our roles very well, but recognize they're just roles. Which you know, because if you are a mother, you're a mother, but when you're a wife, you're a wife. Now, as a wife, you're not the mother, right? You're switching to another role. And then you go to work and you have your profession. Then you're not the mother, you're not the wife, you're another role, right? So as long as we remember that, you know, we're just playing all these different roles, which is necessary, but it's not our true nature, then we're okay. And we can watch ourselves playing these roles.
I want to thank you very much for sharing with us, and I would almost want to thank Buddha to have put you in the world. I would like you maybe to say again the mantra that you were repeating yourself when you were 19. You mentioned that about 2 days ago.
Om Mani Padme Hum.
Om Mani
Padme Hum. Yes, it thank means you. Om. Mani Padme means jewel in the lotus. Home.
Okay, thank you very much.
It's the mantra of Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva of compassion, and since who is also in China called Kuan Yin. So as Tibet regards itself as under the special protection of the Bodhisattva of compassion, it's the universal mantra in Tibet, on all the rocks and everywhere. And it's very easy to say, which is another advantage.
Can you tell us the end of the dream with the prison?
I usually don't tell the end of the dream. It's a little embarrassing. Okay, so I was running outside this endless prison. And then I was going to go back, and then I remembered that my friends were only running because I was running, so therefore, for their sake, I had to keep running. And the moment that this aspiration for the reason I was running was not for me but for them, the prison came to an end, and the prison was going like the road was going like this, and so then I came to a road which went like that. And it was my mind. it was kind of like full of nice, very fancy suburban houses. With there were lawns and trees and nice houses. And so then I went up the path to the first house and knocked on the door. And this very pleasant-looking sort of middle-aged woman answered it. And she said, "Oh, you're from that place. Not many people get out of that place. But don't worry, now you're here, you're very welcome." So I said, "Thank you." And then she said, "But of course, now you are out, you must help others also to get out." And I said, "Yes, well, I tried. But, you know, it's very difficult. I can't do it, you know. I tried before to get more people to come, but they weren't interested. What can I do?" And so she said, "Don't worry, you are not alone. The powers, the higher powers are behind you, and they will help you." So then I said, in that case, I vow to spend the rest of my life helping others to escape. And then I woke up. It's just a dream. I think we'll leave it on that note. Okay, so